4 presents the Mark Steele Lecture, a series of lectures on Englishmen who changed the course of history. Episode 1, Oliver Cromwell.
Oliver Cromwell's extraordinary achievement was to make a civil war popular amongst the English. Now, the Americans and the Spanish, you could understand it. They have a bit of passion. Or the Italians, you can see that. Passion, fire. You could say anything to an Italian. I think you should be able to use a knife with spaghetti. But the English, you could go up to an Englishman and say, I'd like to take away your wife in exchange for a mule. Or, you better go, dear. We don't want to make a fuss. So a civil war in England must have just been thousands of people on fields with pikes facing each other going, well, they said it'd be sunny in the fall, can't. Oliver Cromwell was an astonishing character. He was one of the great military commanders of all time, and yet when he began his military career, he was a 42-year-old farmer from East Anglia. Now, our image of him is of him yelling things like, march forth for God and for England! But in reality, his orders must have been things like, calm you down. You don't want to go down Bury St. Edmunds. Rat race down there. Cromwell was born in 1599 at a time when most people's lives were dominated by two institutions, the church and the monarchy. The church was the local government. It distributed relief for the poor. It organised the only entertainment. It educated children. The weekly sermon was the only source of information, providing the news, especially local news. So a service probably ended.
And here are the main points of the sermon again. The king has apologised for recent remarks in which he said that a candlestick at one of his residences must have been installed by an Indian.
And if you're taking the kids to the Southwold witch burning this weekend, don't forget there are roadworks on the Ipswich Turnpike.
The other dominant institution was the monarchy. The king called Parliament whenever he liked, usually to raise a new tax, and he dismissed it whenever he liked. All English men and women were members of the Church of England, whether they liked it or not. It was an offence not to attend on a Sunday. It was even an offence to attend a church outside your own parish, which was probably to stop the middle classes going, well, we know that Nathan and Jemima ought to go to the local church, but the one at Kensington's got such marvellous facilities. But in some ways, the most decisive aspect of royal power was in terms of ideas. The king was seen by most people as God's envoy on earth. A story, for example, was circulated that the king's spit had cured a sick child. Now, since then, we've had 350 years of medical advances, and I bet if someone started up a similar story now, you'd have half of Islington going, we don't touch antibiotics anymore. We go to the Gobbo Therapy Centre on Upper Street. Anyone who questioned the status quo was in trouble. In 1634, a lawyer called William Prynne printed an attack on the Queen and was sentenced to be
fined, pilloried, and have his ears cropped.
3 years later, he was caught again for publishing another seditious paper called News from Ipswich. How can anything be a threat to the state when it's called News from Ipswich? From the early 1600s onwards, these radical ideas found expression in the ideals and beliefs of the Puritans, whose most famous disciple came to be Oliver Cromwell. So what did Puritans believe? Well, according to one current schoolbook, The English Civil War,
as a strict Puritan, Cromwell believed in hard work. He had no time for sinful pleasures, such as gambling, going to the theatre, or eating Christmas dinner.
How can anyone honestly believe that a mass following can be built for a religion on not doing three random things, one of which is eating Christmas dinner? And besides, if Puritans were just obsessed with being miserable, how did they take off as a religious movement? Well, in the Catholic and the old Protestant church, people worshipped God via the priest. The common man or woman couldn't get through to God except through this intermediary. So the priest was like an important person's secretary. And if anyone tried to get in touch with God directly, they got the priest going,
I'm afraid he's in a meeting at the moment.
But the Puritans came from a different background, mostly small landowners and craftsmen, what were called the middling sort. So they believed in each person having their own individual relationship with God. So Cromwell talked about wrestling with God, trying to work out each day what God wanted you to decide on earth. At the age of 18, Cromwell became a student at Cambridge, where, according to James Heath, he would accost women in the streets in order to
perforce ravish a kiss or some lewder satisfaction upon them.
So he was just like any male student. After his studies, Cromwell lived in London until, with his new wife, he returned home to help run the family estate. But he had hardly any income, and he was dependent on the odd bits of inheritance that were coming through to him as his old relatives died. Cromwell then became depressed, and he visited a physician called Sir Theodore Mayerne, who described him as
extremely melancholy.
But there was no counselling in them days, because what use would it have been?
So, after your land was enclosed and you were forced into the town as vagabonds, and your family all got the plague, did you feel resentful in any way?
It's assumed that during this period, Cromwell had a sudden conversion, becoming a fully-fledged Puritan activist. But more likely, I think, is that his move towards religious activism at this time was the result of the political events happening in the country. In 1628, he used his influence to become an MP for Huntingdon. The political situation heightened his depression. The petition of right had been introduced by Parliament to make unparliamentary taxation illegal. But then the king just declared it null and void, along with his closest advisor, who was called Archbishop Laud. Then when Charles I in 1629 wound the Parliament up altogether, Cromwell said that the petition of right should actually have been called the petition of shite. How childish can you get? This is one of the greatest characters in English history with a mental age of about six. Sat at the back of Parliament going, petition of right, more like this is a shite. Archbishop Laud was singled out as a hate figure, as it was feared that he was going to bring back Catholicism. And so then on May the 9th, 1640, a leaflet was posted on the Old Exchange calling on apprentices to invade Lambeth Palace. In Laud's diary for May the 11th, he wrote,
at midnight, my house at Lambeth was beset with 500 of these rascal routers. I strengthened the house as well as I could. They continued there for 2 full hours.
Laud fled from the palace by river, which must have created one of the most amazing sights in all history. An archbishop desperately rowing across the Thames in all his gear, probably using the crook as an oar, while anyone walking along the embankment must have gone, oh, look, they're filming a Monty Python sketch. There was more resistance to the king when he introduced the ship tax to pay for the navy. Now, previously, this had only been payable in the coastal areas, but it was now extended across the whole country. So a campaign was led by a squire from Buckingham called John Hampden, who refused to pay. So a mass non-payment campaign developed. So there were probably marches of thousands of people going, no ship tax, no ship tax, can't payeth, won't payeth, no ship tax. And I expect the king tried to defuse the situation by giving it another name. It is not the ship tax, it is the maritime charge! Cromwell must have watched these movements with fascination. In 1640, he became MP for St Ives when Charles recalled the Parliament to deal with his financial crisis. Opposition to the king in Parliament was led by a man called John Pym. So the king decided to arrest John Pym and 4 of his colleagues in the House of Commons. But the word got out and the 5 MPs escaped just in time. And thousands of Londoners marched through London the next day in defence of the 5 MPs. And this was the first ever really demonstration. It wasn't just sort of like now where people just wander along like it's a job. Oh, hello, you're a bit late. What one is it today? Is it Ireland? I can't remember. The king rode to Nottingham with his family on August the 22nd, 1642. He held a ceremony in the rain in which the king declared war. His herald read out the king's proclamation, but Charles had amended the original. And so the herald had to keep stopping because he couldn't read Charles's writing. Then the royal flag was raised as a symbol of the war, but a gale blew it over and there was a big argument where nobody wanted to put it back up again because they didn't want to get out in the rain. And I bet there were still people going, yeah, but they do a marvellous job and they bring in a lot of tourists.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.